or phobia thereof? So now, beginning with the current scenario in which our entrepreneurial ventures as well as MSMEs have been trying their best to thrive in the economy, is basically the major problems that they have been facing while trying their best to thrive. We have the biggest problem that is being faced rampantly is a payment delay, which may be to the according to the reports to be to the tune of 40,000 crores for large corporates and for PSUs to the tune of 48,000 crores. Now, this entire scenario has been created in a way that the MSMEs, despite following the entire system, still need to go behind the buyer and need to basically, try and get the payments on time. So the payment cycles are hugely affected. Like we can see here, almost for any MSME who has a credit period of say 30 days, that is easily taken to a 45 days, and anybody who has a 60 days, maybe it also does go to a 90 day scenario. Now this recovery cycle as well is very sort of a big challenge for the MSMEs who need to, on a constant basis after supplying of their goods, be in touch with all these purchase departments of the PSUs as well as the large corporates. Also, if you can see, almost 17% of the MSMEs end up writing off a part of their, a fifth, as it is mentioned here, a fifth of their receivables because of not being able to recover the same. Now, as it is widely acknowledged, MSMEs do contribute heavily to the Indian economy. Time and again, we have hailed MSME segment as being the biggest job creator, apart from the PSUs, contributing 38% to the Indian GDP, on the rise always. And of course, a lot of contribution in the total exports of the country as well. So now, apart from the problem of delayed payments, there is an issue of inadequate funding for the which serves as a hindrance or constraint to the growth of these MSMEs. Now, like here we can see there are a lot of issues basically. At least in a country, developing country like us, we have major inadequacy as far as market linkages are concerned. There is also a lack of proper infrastructure, which is of course being, that's a perennial process. Government is always in the process of improving and developing the infrastructure to best support the different industries which are there in the country. And then we can see there's a lack of managerial competence, there is obsolete technology, and to add to all this, there is a major issue of inadequate finance. Now, when I talk about inadequate finance, more so in this during these times, although there is credit always available in the market, but this credit comes at a cost which has almost skyrocketed because of the economic cash crunch which has plagued industries across the segment, not just MSMEs, but these big MNCs also now are in a mode in which they have almost started the cost cutting and reservation to the fullest. So of course, there is documentation, which is one more challenge when we talk about inadequate funding. There is a problem with the collateral that the MSMEs need to give in order to be eligible to have a secured funding from any financial institution. So out of the entire MSME spectrum, almost 66% of the MSMEs are, do not stand eligible to be funded through secured lending, where the rates of interest are comparatively lower. They do not stand eligible for those lending programs by all these commercial banks which are there. So here, basically, we can see there's a huge gap in the demand and supply as far as credit is concerned for the MSMEs. Now, when we come to the access to financial formal banking channels, basically here we have this small breakup which shows us that mostly the MSMEs, which primarily if we talk about the micro members of the MSME spectrum, self-finance or maybe for the others who coming into the spectrum of small or medium MSMEs, for them a huge part of their equity consists of self-finance. Then there is obviously financial assistance, which is made available by government sources, by the fact that there are certain criteria for the government-based programs, which the MSME needs to be eligible for. Only then they will be able to avail these financial assistances. Then there is borrowing from financial institutions, where we just saw in the previous slide that there are quite a couple of challenges while trying to borrow from the financial institutions. And then there is borrowing from these non-institutional money lenders. Apart from that, we can see there are a few non-formal lending setups. For example, these self-help groups or joint liability groups, which are not big enough to cater to the growing needs and demands of MSMEs. Now, government, time and again, the Reserve Bank of India, Ministry of Corporate Affairs, Finance Department has been trying to brainstorm and get to formulate various programs and resolutions for trying to help out the MSMEs strive or grow in this in our economic system. So maybe first they began with the MSME Act, on which the entire trades exchange is based. So this act basically says that an MSME, one from the date of acceptance of goods, is eligible for a payment within 45 days. So that was a landmark decision that was taken by the government. And then in 2012, governments went forward and said that the firms with audited accounts must disclose what is their MSME obligation as in the closing of the accounts in the financial year. In 2015, the MSME Samadhan setup was bought out as a redressal mechanism, which has been effective, if not effective to say 100%, but has been quite effective in redressing the grievances to a certain extent. Now, in 2015, RBI also issued basically came up with the guidelines for the Trade Receivable Electronic Discounting System, which stands for TREDS. Now, in 2019, RBI panel suggested setting up a spot payment for defaulters, which again is something that has also created certain fear in the minds of the defaulters. Now, coming to the background or the evolution of TREDS, basically, the TREDS system has a very the genesis of the trade system is laid way back in 2008, 2009. The whole foundation was laid almost over a decade back during Mr. Raghuram Rajan's time when he was the chairman of the Financial Reforms Committee. So basically, it was realized that the large-scale delays, which are creating huge problems for the MSMEs in terms of regulating their payment cycle, needs to be addressed in a more solid and compounded way. So in Mexico, which as a country, they were having a similar system where they were implementing something like TREDS in their economy, which was benefiting the MSMEs. So a team of SIDBI was sent there, who spoke to all the stakeholders, the customers, the technology partners, the various corporates, and gathered their insights and came back and formulated these guidelines. And then NSE and SIDBI jointly applied for the TREDS license to the Reserve Bank of India guidelines. Now they began by something called as the Trade Receivables Engine for e-discounting, inspired by the Mexican model called NAFIN. And once the applications were called in from all the interested parties for setting up the trades exchange, SIDBI being the torch bearer in the discounting formal discounting scenario, jointly with NSE applied for the license. Now in December 2015, RBI gave in the in principle approval to SIDBI and NSE for operating trades as per the guidelines, and then in February 2016, SIDBI and NSE jointly formed RXIL, Receivables Exchange of India Limited. Now in December 2016, the final approval was released from RBI, and other shareholders also joined in as investors in RXIL. And the first ever trades transaction in the country happened in January 2017. And RXIL was the exchange which facilitated this first transaction. Now about RXIL, basically the sole motto of RXIL is to formalize the e-discounting facility, which is an easy access to credit by the MSMEs. Now, besides SIDBI and NSE, we have countries' big names, for example, SBI, the ICICI Group, and Yes Bank, who have come together and are the stakeholders in RXIL. And the innovate, like the basic idea behind RXIL was to form an innovative digital platform where we can bring in all the stakeholders, the large corporates, the buyers, the second participant being the MSME sellers, and the banking partners, the financiers, into one single seamless interface. So here, these are the visions that we have like been working day and night with in RXIL. It's an integrated provider of financing platform for, again, supporting the growth and development of the micro, small, medium enterprises. It is also aiming to effectively be able to manage the supply chain finance for the MSMEs, enhance the transparency in the system, as it is an electronic discounting system. That factor is already addressed, being an e-discounting platform. And then we strive to reach 1 lakh MSMEs by the end of financial year 2020-22. Now, coming down to the model in which trades functions. So, like I told, there are three different participants on the platform. The first one being the buyer. So buyer, any large corporate, any PSU, any government agency, or any MNC, which is procuring from MSMEs, is eligible to get themselves registered or empanel themselves as buyers on the trades platform. Having said that, the sellers will be the companies which have their MSME registrations and are supplying to any of these buyers. They can come up and they can register themselves as the MSME sellers on the platform. Now, the third participant is a financier. Financiers are the banks, the factoring companies, and the NBFC factors who come under the Factoring Act of 2011. So that is a separate act which defines by RBI, which defines the financial institutions which can participate in this entire trades transaction as the financier or as the funders. So here, one buyer, say a MNC buyer, might have multiple vendors. Let's assume 300 odd vendors. Now, each of these vendors might also be supplying to other large corporates or MNCs or PSUs. So on this platform, once any entity is registered as a buyer or as a seller, we basically do an exercise, which I will take you through in the further slides, that is known as a buyer-seller link establishment. So the buyer and the seller are connected to each other through a unique link, so that on this platform, each seller has an access to the other buyer, and each buyer can have access to multiple sellers. It's just a matter of establishing a link between the two. So now, once that is done and the invoices come to the e-discounting platform, we have all these financiers who are there, multiple financiers. They get a chance to participate in this e-discounting process. Now, RxAL has been this one-stop solution where we look forward to address not just the backward and the forward linkage part, but also the various other challenges that I just mentioned in a couple of slides back regarding availing credit facility. For example, there is no collateral that is taken from the MSME seller to avail this e-discounting facility. As well as there is minimal documentation, only the once a registration is done, the invoice, single piece of invoice needs to be uploaded, and the same goes forward and gets discounted. So RBI enables the financiers to buy these invoices basically from the seller and then settle the payments from the buyer to the financier. And then the entire cycle just begins when the seller is supplying any goods or services to the buyer and then raising an invoice, mentioning this certain credit period that is there between agreed payment terms between the buyer and the seller. Once this first process is done, the supply of the goods and raising of invoices and then subsequent submission of the invoices to the buyer. So the buyer basically follows their own existing method of processing the invoices offline. Once that part is done, the seller uploads the invoice on the platform. The buyer takes a look and approves the invoice on our platform. They log into our platform and approve it. Since they've already done it offline, the entire process is completed. So they come on the platform, they approve these invoices, and then the financier makes a settlement or a payment to the seller. Once this due date arrives, the financier basically takes the payment from the buyer and gives it, I mean, RxAL will take the payment from the buyer and give it back to the financier. So this will complete the entire cycle. Now coming to the buyer-seller link, which I just told a couple of slides back, the buyer-seller link is just like a digital handshake between the buyer and the seller. This one link will define the entire relationship between the both parties. For example, there will be certain fields where details need to be filled up to capture some important information, which will be like what is the default credit period or the extended credit period that is there, that is the understanding between the buyer and the seller. This is initiated by the buyer and accepted by the seller. There are a few more details as well. For example, the transaction charge, which is there. Who is the bearer of this transaction charge? Or if in case there is a splitting of cost between the buyer and the seller. And of course, there is a cap rate. There is a cash discount. So all these fields are there. Whichever is applicable to the buyer and seller arrangement, those fields need to be filled up by the buyer and sent forward for acceptance to the seller. Now, once the seller is accepting this thing called the buyer-seller link, and the link is established between the two, the invoices can start getting uploaded in the against the buyer. So basically, once this entire link gets established, seller can log into their platform at any moment and start uploading these invoices in the name of the buyer. Now we'll just take another look at this workflow. So the MSME vendors will upload the invoices after the submission of the hard copy of the invoices. They will upload the same on our platform. These invoices will be visible to the buyer once they log in. The buyer will give their approval on the uploaded invoices. Then the invoice moves to the window where the financiers can view it. Once they view it, they will be placing bids. Now, these bids are a factor of how the what is the market standing of the buyer. So that is one of the biggest advantages of a alternate financing channel like TREDS, where basically the MSMEs are getting the access to credit, but the recourse is to the buyer. As in, the entire credit option is available to them on the buyer's market reputation or credit rating. So the financiers take a look at what has been the repayment track of the buyer, and what has been the buyer's credit rating and overall market feedback. Once that is there, that is always a process which is done in the back end, and it is finished only then these bids will start coming. So the bids start coming. Once the bid, the best lowest bid is accepted by the MSME vendor, the obligation is created on the name of the buyer, not the vendor. Like I told, the vendor will get the payment, but the obligation is generated in the name of the buyer, which the buyer has to honor on the due date. What is the accepted due date? Now, once the obligation is generated, on T plus one day, the MSME vendor gets a payment in his account, and the mechanism we follow is called NACH, which is under the National Payment Corporation of India. Then on the due date, there is a debit which is done on the buyer's account, and the payment is pulled from the buyer's account and credited to the account of the financier. Now that completes the cycle of the invoice discounting. However, the MSME company, once they get the payment on the T plus one day, they are out of the system, because the obligation is no more on the vendor. The obligation shifts to the buyer. On the due date, the buyer is supposed to make a payment. Now, coming to process, like I told, it's the same thing. The seller has to upload it. Once the seller uploads, the buyer approves the factoring unit. The finances start giving bids. Once the bids are received, if the seller is bearing the cost, it is called as a factoring process. The seller is the entity which will accept the bid, because they are also bearing the interest cost. Now, the seller accepts the invoice, and within 48 hours of acceptance, the financiers pay to the seller. On the due date, the buyer pays the outstanding amount to the financier, and the factoring is completed. So this process where the interest is borne by the seller is known as the factoring process. There is another process which is known as the reverse factoring process. Now, in reverse factoring, this is sometimes the case with the private buyers, the big buyers, mostly private ones. They choose to bear the interest cost. Now, in that scenario, what actually happens is the buyer goes ahead, uploads the invoices, and since the buyer is uploading, it's by default accepted. If the seller approves, usually it will go to the buyer. Buyer needs to accept it on the platform. Then it moves to the discounting window. Whereas in reverse factoring, since the buyer is uploading, the invoice immediately moves to the auction window. Once it moves to the auction window, the financiers will bid for it. Once the most suitable bids are available, the buyer goes ahead and chooses the bids. Once the bid has been chosen, the payment is credited to the seller's account within 48 hours. And then buyer settles the payment with the financier mostly on the agreed due date. Or if in case there is any extended credit period, then it is taken care of by the financier. Now, in the entire process, if we try to look at the different benefits that the MSME seller is getting, I feel the most important and the biggest advantage is the seller receives the payment within 48 hours of the approval of the invoices. Now, when I tell that it is within 48 hours, so there are basically two different shifts in which the trades exchange functions. So I'll discuss about it a little later. Here I'll just give a brief. Now, if any invoice is factored as in if the bids for any invoices are accepted from morning 9 a.m. to evening 4 p.m. then the payment gets credited into the account of the MSME seller on the next day, which is the T plus one day, within banking operation hours, that is from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. next day, the amount gets credited into the account of the seller. However, if the bids are accepted by the cost-bearing party, seller or buyer, after 4 p.m. on any given day, so in the range of 4 p.m. to 9 p.m., then the credit, the payment comes to the account of the MSME vendor on T plus 2 day. So for example, if 1st of July before 4 p.m. the interest bids have been accepted by the seller, the amount is credited into the account within 6 p.m. of 2nd July. Now, if the bids have been accepted after 4 p.m. by the MSME seller, then on 3rd July, the payment comes to the account of the MSME seller. Now, for this, the MSMEs are not restricted to any single bank. As opposed to in conventional banking, usually whenever any MSME will approach a banker, a foreign bank or say a private bank for bill discounting, so they're restricted to that one bank, and there is no alternative. So the interest rates which are quoted are usually higher to the tune of any unsecured lending, maybe say a 13%, 14%, or maybe a best of 11%. So seeing that is just because there is this one option, there is no choice for the MSMEs. However, since this is an exchange or a platform or a marketplace, there are multiple financiers. So we have close to 40 financiers who are there on the platform. So they compete among themselves to basically grab the MSME invoices. So that is one of the advantages. Apart from getting a quick and a smooth payment, there is fund comes at a very low cost. Now, apart from that, like I mentioned, this entire setup has been created such that there is no recourse to the seller. As in, there is no obligation on the part of the seller to pay back to the financier. Ultimately, on the due date, the buyer is solely responsible for the payment, and the it is ensured that the financier is paid back through a auto debit on the buyer's account. Now, we'll come to the benefits which are there for the buyer, the corporates who are going forward and providing this kind of a facility to their MSMEs. So what they basically gain from this is, the most important part is the vendor base. So now their entire vendor base, their vendor relationships are strengthened as the platform is allowing for these seamless transactions to happen. Then we also provide the buyer with the ERP integration solution. So once the invoices are uploaded on our platform by the vendors, the same need not be manually approved by the buyer. Instead, the system can be programmed in such a way that each invoice which is uploaded, details of the invoices are matched with the database of the buyer. If those invoices have been processed and the voucher has been created for a payment or has been forwarded to the cash for a payment and the net payable amount and everything has been decided, then automatically, seamlessly, the information comes on the platform and the same is eligible for getting discounted. Of course, there is an added advantage of having better terms during procurement. Since the suppliers are being provided with a competitive price discovery through this entire auction mechanism, even buyers are able to benefit by getting better quotes from the vendors. Now, coming to the benefits for the third participant on the platform, which is the financiers. Now, in case of a conventional loaning process, the financiers have to go through the entire profile of the borrower, do their own credit assessment, and finalize whether the applying entity is eligible or not. However, in a system like TReDS, every entity has been pre-qualified, and post the registration, the buyer can directly go ahead and start discounting the invoices. So the cost of customer acquisition is reduced to a minuscule, as well as RBI, in order to encourage all the financiers to participate in this TReDS transactions, RBI has also taken this, all the transactions that happen on TReDS, as the priority sector lending status. So all the TReDS transactions that a bank is participating in will be accounting for its PSL lending within a year. Then there is a low risk default. As I told, we work on this NACH mechanism where the buyer's accounts are auto debited, so there is hardly any chances of default. And overall, the system has been designed in a way that it's a win-win for all the parties which are involved. So now to enforce this TREDS initiative in the economic system, government came out with the mandate to cover all the PSUs or government departments to get themselves registered on the platform. Now this notification came out on October 24, 2017. Post that, like I mentioned, TREDS transactions were categorized as PSL for banks. And then Government of India, through this DFS, also made sure that the periodic information is taken from the PSUs regarding how much volume have they done through TREDS and how many of their vendors have now come on board. This has hugely increased the speed of the MSME onboarding, especially in a year or so. The PSUs have been sensitized, and now in turn they're sensitizing their entire MSME vendor base to get themselves registered to take advantage of this facility which is being given to them. Apart from this, in November 2018, one more mandate came from Ministry of MSME, and it is being enforced by MCA. The mandate states that any private company which has a turnover greater than 500 crore and any PSU, irrespective of the turnover, they have to get themselves registered on TREDS. Time and again, we have also seen that in the budget, especially in the Union Budget of 2021, announcements were made that NBFCs can also now take part in the TREDS platform. So, which will again bring a lot of buyers which have a comparatively lower credit rating also into the entire spectrum. So not just the A rated buyers, but other low rated buyers also can participate, and their MSME vendors can in turn get benefit. However, this is taking some time to get rolled out in a full fledged way, but this is what will be happening since it has already now been mentioned in our budget. Now, talking about something, a joint venture which has been initiated, and I'm sure a lot of the MSMEs present here might be aware, the government e-marketplace or GEMS, RXIL TREDS platform has now integrated with GEMS, and it is being ensured that like GEMS is already working towards making sure that the payments for the MSME supplies are being made in a time-bound manner. Now, TREDS has joined hands with GEMS to ensure that the discounting route is also available for the MSME supply. So, in case they are going to get a payment within 10 days or 15 days, now they did not wait for that. They can directly get it discounted on day one, and for the next 10-15 days, they can enjoy the credit. Now, looking at how this TREDS is looking forward to address the delayed payment issue, since it is mandated now for all the PSUs and state enterprises to come and get themselves registered and route the entire MSME payment through TREDS, it has seen a lot of traction from the state level as well as central level procuring authorities. Now, banks are getting encouraged to again reduce the rates of interest proportionately to the decrease in the repo. That has also hugely benefited the vendors, because we have seen the rates, the average rates, which were say close to 8%, now come down to something like 6.5%. So that is how much we have seen the interest rates come down in the last, like off late, this has been the decrease that we have noticed. Again, the proposed MSME classifications, the new MSME classifications which have come in, that have also brought in a lot of other companies in this list, and even they can now go ahead and enjoy this e-discounting facility. Another thing which has been brought up and successfully implemented is the direct linkage with the GST network. To some extent, it is able to pull out the data and validate the real-time GST and invoice data to understand the authenticity of the transactions or the volumes that are there. So apart from this, a lot of industry associations have been working seamlessly and trying to sensitize the MSME community about TREDS and how this alternate financing channel can address, if not entirely the payment issues, but to certain extent, the delayed payment issues are getting addressed. And this comes with fact that there is minimal documentation and very competitive rates. Now that is all about the process in which TREDS functions, the Trade Receivable Electronic Discounting System functions, and the genesis of TREDS. Now, if we talk about the new initiatives that have been implemented, especially to encounter the current pandemic situation, so there are a couple of things that the TREDS Exchange has done, beginning with the online registration process. So maybe say 6 months down the line, the entire registration was a offline registration process, and there were exchange of hard copies. So the MSME vendors had to fill up all these application forms and everything, take due printouts and do an entire process, and then courier the hard copies. Now these hard copies will be scrutinized by the operations and the backend, and those hard copies, in case there is anything missing, a rework was suggested, and then ultimately after all the documentation was complete, it was done. Now what is being done is the entire registration process has been made online. So instead of reworking on the same hard copy and exchange of these hard copies, the application form has been made digital. So any MSME who wants to register, at a click of a button, they can start the registration process. They can fill up the details one by one. In case of any queries, they can get back to our team. They get assistance. They're able to fill up the details. Once the details are completely correct and filled up, then our team gives a go-ahead to the vendors. The vendor then downloads the document. Now the document is fully validated by our team. So this ready-made document is then downloaded, and then the document is signed and sent across to our team. That ensures that there is no discrepancy, since our team has already gone through the document prior to the printout itself. And of course, as mentioned here, the requirements are very minimal. For example, the annual report, which has been mentioned here, it only needs to be submitted in terms of, say, the balance sheet page and the profit and loss page. So two pages for two consecutive years, and the MSME proofs for each MSME registration. Now, coming to a few testimonials, now a supplier for a leading OEM manufacturer has, we've quoted him saying that registering with RXIL has been a great experience. And this cooperation and efficiency which the like RXIL executives have extended have like made the process effortless, and it has been quite a hassle-free journey for them. Similarly, we have one of our just like RXIL has tried to encounter this COVID situation by creating an online platform for registration, SIDBI, our parent company, they have also set up SCRF, the Swabalamban Crisis Responsive Fund, in which they are basically supporting the free onboarding of all the MSMEs on TREDS. So prior to this COVID situation, there was a minimal registration fee for the MSME vendors. Now the entire registration fee has been, and the renewal fee also, has been waived off. And SIDBI is supporting the vendors through this SCR fund. Now, with this, we come to the end of the presentation.
Thank you, ma'am. Before I open the session, a few questions are already there on the chat. The first question is being asked by Mr. B.S. Srinivasan. Please let us know if PSUs are accepting TREDS. For example, ITI banking plant is not registered on TREDS.
Sorry, can you repeat the question, sir?
This question is from Mr. B.S. Srinivasan. Please let us know if PSUs are accepting TREDS. For example, ITI banking plant is not registered on TREDS.
Yeah. So now coming to this question, like I mentioned earlier, PSUs, irrespective of their turnover, are mandated to get themselves registered on the platform. So each and every PSU must be registered on the platform. However, the count is so huge that all the like we are yet to complete the registration for all the PSUs existing in the country, because we are talking about the state PSUs as well as the central PSUs, all the CPSEs. Now, talking specifically about ITI, now ITI is registered on TREDS. However, when we talk about the buyer being registered, there is another underlying condition, which is the buyer has to have a good credit rating for the bankers to take a exposure on them. So despite ITI being registered, the looking at the past repayment track record, the bankers are not willing to take a call on ITI. So that is the case with ITI Bangalore. But other PSUs are registered, and many of them are active also, actively doing transactions. Next question, please.
Mr. Srinivas SV has a question, ma'am. He says, can SMEs be registered in TREDS?
Provided the buyer is okay to route them to the platform.
Please go ahead, ma'am. It's like disturbance. Yeah. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So service bills are discountable on the platform, provided the buyer is buyer agrees to route these service bills through RxSale. Because mostly for the service bills, the credit period is not defined. So mostly the scenario is on the payment for the service bill should be immediate, instant. Once the services have been rendered, the payment should be immediate. So because of that, a lot of buyers are hesitant to route the service bills to through us. They would rather like to make a direct payment, which is quicker. That's what the buyer still, but then if the buyer agrees, it can be discounted on the platform. So next question.
What is the current rate of interest for bill discounting as of now, ma'am?
So I'll be able to give you a range. Now we have seen a range of 5.65% up till 12% on the platform. This has been the range in which the interest rate moves. Now, especially during this COVID scenario, the rates have dropped hugely. So all these below 7% rates have come in during this COVID period, because even financiers are not able to function and lend to the MSMEs like they were doing prior to the COVID levels. So because of that, they find it most convenient to lend it, to do the lending through the TREDS platform. So they have been increasingly giving very competitive rates. So we have seen that the average interest rate has fallen close to 7% now, so 7.1, 7.2. So that is where it is hovering around. And it's a per annum basis that I'm telling you.
And a supplementary question, ma'am, what is the processing fee?
So like I told you, the there is one fee, which is the registration fee. That registration fee is basically dependent on the buyer. So for PSUs, there's a different slab. And for the private sector companies, a different slab, which again keeps changing depending.
Ms. Sahu's line has got cut. I think he will reconnect. Please hold on.
Hello. So your mic is on mute. Am I audible?
Yeah. Please go ahead, ma'am. Please go ahead.
So like I was mentioning about the processing fee. So there is one registration fee which depends on the type of buyer. I mean, the registration fee is different for the PSUs and different for the private sector companies, depending on what is the buyer discussion. Now, apart from the one-time registration fee, there is a interest charge which is pertaining to a single invoice transaction. Apart from the interest cost, there is a transaction fee as well. So there are in total three cost components here. So registration fee is a one-time activity and the annual activity, whereas the interest fee and the transaction fee is a per invoice activity. The interest rate is in the range of 5.65% up to the range of 12%, and the transaction fee is 0.35% per annum per invoice. The next question, please.
Yeah, the floor is open. Anybody can ask the question, please. Go ahead.
Hello, can I come in, sir?
Please go ahead, sir.
So, my question, I am Lakshmi Shah. My question is, if my customer is not registered with you, will I able to participate?
Okay, so I'll just answer this question. Now, for the discounting to happen, sir, both the buyer, as in your customer, and you have to get registered on the platform. Because now, once the factoring has been done, the discounting has been done, the obligation to pay back to the bank goes to the buyer. So, if the buyer is not registered on the platform and does not accept the entire transaction on the platform, then the obligation cannot be shifted to the buyer. That's why both you as well as your customer compulsorily have to register on the platform so that you can discount their invoices.
Madam, further to this particular thing, as you told, all PSUs and companies above 500 crores are, mandated to get registered under this particular trade, sir. But 99% of the, hello?
Yes, sir, I'm there.
Hello? But 98, around 95 to 98% of the MSMEs supply to companies lesser than this particular turnover, this one. But turnover limit should be made 50 or 100 crores. Then only it is eligible for this MSMEs to utilize this. Otherwise, the micro and small will not be able to utilize this service at all, madam.
Right, sir. We have also highlighted the same to MSME Ministry and Ministry of Corporate Affairs, and we are in talks with them to decrease this threshold beyond 500 crores.
So third question, ma'am. One more thing. In this, this utility companies like BESCOM, BWSSB or something, are they mandated to get registered on, with the trades?
Yes, sir. They're mandated to get registered.
But none of these were state, this particular, they are not registered till today. Yeah, what action can be taken by the supplier to the those people? What action I can take it? Is there any provision in the law?
There is a gadgeted notification which mandates these PSUs. You can what I'll do is I'll basically forward this to Mr. Shekhar. Once they circulate the presentation, they will also circulate the gadgeted notification that can be used, and the buyer can be brought to accept the entire trades transaction.
Thank you very much, ma'am.
Madam,
Also, the BESCOM is already registered. So in case you're looking forward to discount any bills for BESCOM, do let us know. It is already registered on the platform. Yes,
thank
sir,
you very
next
much, ma'am.
question.
Thank you.
Mr. Manish Kola has a question, ma'am. Can you please repeat the figure? 0.35% of the invoice is the transaction fee, is irrespective of the cost of invoice?
Right, sir. It's irrespective of the cost of invoice.
Okay. Any other question from the participants, please?
If there is no more questions, I do have one or two points. Shekhar, can I go ahead?
Please go ahead, sir.
Good afternoon, Madam Shangri-La. It's a wonderful presentation today. And
thank you,
when I saw, when they saw the, I'm Srinivasan, Vice President from Laghu Udyog Bharati, and also a company, Wiprof Electronics. We have been dealing with PSUs in government for the last 35 years. Ma'am, this FEDS scheme that you have explained today, if the interest rate is 5.5% to 12% and per invoice charge of 0.35% plus registration fee, it is highly unviable for micro and small industries to accept this FEDS platform. The reason being, we are working at very, very low margins, and it is impossible for us to bear such a heavy fee for discounting. No wonder none of the schemes are effectively utilized by the MSME. Point number one. And point number two, as my joint secretary has told, the threshold has to be reduced below 100 crores. And maybe the government effort to be in such a serious action to be taken on the PSUs and the government sector for the supply bill of MSME, that if they don't pay within 30 to 45 days, either with FEDS or without FEDS, they should be imprisoned. There is no other way of solving this problem, which is rampant. And the point you mentioned that MSME bills with the public sector and the government is in excess of 5 lakh crores pending as on date. And this we have brought it to the minister's notice, and he has agreed in principle that he is going to issue a whip to all the PSUs to clear the bill. Thank you, ma'am.
Right, sir. Thank you.
Is there any other questions from the participants? I think we should close now, ma'am. Thanks a lot, madam, for the excellent and comprehensive presentation on threats. A lot of inputs and insights have been shared by you to all of the participants. I'm sure it's been a quite a learning experience for all of us. Can I request Mr. Bhojraj, our Honorary Secretary, to kindly thank you and conclude the session, ma'am?
Sure, sir.
Mr. Bhojraj? Mr. Srinivasan, please conclude the session. Mr. B.S. Srinivasan?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, please go ahead, sir. Please conclude the session, sir.
Yeah, thank you very much, Shekhar, for organizing this wonderful event of RXIL. And it's one of the National Stock Exchange and SIDBI joint venture. And we could understand the scheme and the way the things, the FEDS Act and of the RBI, and how the financial sector reforms are going to be carried on. And the examples that they mentioned, how the Mexico, MSMEs in Mexico are benefiting from the scheme. I appreciate the government's effort in bringing the scheme over, and RXIL also to help our micro and small enterprise fraternity. And she also explained very well on the factoring process flow and also the reverse factoring process flow and the benefits for MSME to get on the sellers to get the payment quickly within 48 hours. And good thing that with people who have margin of more than 20-25% could opt this FEDS platform. And also to bring the companies to book regarding the delayed payment problems that most of the MSMEs are facing today. And the registration is online with a letter of authorization and the master agreement. And the processing fee is a one-time registration fee. And there's an interest fee component for every transaction and also a transaction fee of 0.35% per invoice. I thank all the participants for being here today. And I request all of you to use this for the TREDS platform for the business. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. We formally close the session now.